Hi, everyone. My name is Anirudh. I went to that school across the bay, but I'm here. So I graduated from UC Berkeley in 2000. Like, it was class of 2013, and I've been working at Twitter for about a year and a half today. One of the main frameworks that I have been working on is a technology called the Time Series Aggregator. The acronym is Tsar, stands for Time Series Aggregator. It's hard to follow along. But essentially, so today I'm very excited to talk to you about it. It's been in production at Twitter for about 6 months to a year at this point, and various teams around Twitter use it. So let's actually dive into it. So at the very outset, what is Tsar itself? Tsar is a framework and a service infrastructure for specifying time series aggregation jobs. So the first question that this brings up is, what exactly is a time series aggregation? One way of thinking about it is, Twitter has many, many publishers who post content onto Twitter. So for example, you are New York Times, and New York Times sends a tweet out into Twitter. They want to be able to track how many people saw their tweet today versus how many people saw it yesterday versus how many people saw it a week back. If I am a publisher like BuzzFeed, I want to know how many people have mentioned BuzzFeed, like how much engagement am I receiving on Twitter? And I want to track this week over week, month over month, year over year. So essentially, this kind of information is you are aggregating on a particular publisher, and what you're computing is engagements that have been sent to that publisher. And you're exposing this as a time series, so exposing this like today versus 1 week back versus 1 month. So here you're performing a time series aggregation. One of the things that we realized while we were working at Twitter is this notion, or this class of analytics problems, which is time series aggregations, is actually a very, very common problem that comes up very often. It accounts for a very large percentage of the analytics problems that people solve at Twitter. And we've been solving it, and this has been a multi-year effort, as we'll soon see. So one of the things that our team did was we built a specialized framework, which we call Tsar, that is specifically geared towards solving this problem. And we solve it in a robust manner, so you don't have to keep solving it. And we also build many, many best practices into it, so it's easy to do and solve these problems itself. So what is the use case of time series aggregations at Twitter itself? There are multiple use cases. The big ones that we talk about, that I've spoken about here, are the first use case is kind of what I alluded to right now, is data products itself. So if you go to analytics.twitter.com today, you as a user are displayed with a dashboard that shows how many favorites you have received over time, how many replies you have received over time, how many retweets you have received over time. As a user, you can see what are the top tweets of yours, and what were the top tweets maybe 1 week back. So these are various data products that are surfaced to Twitter users and to Twitter advertisers and publishers. We use time series aggregations to compute various business metrics. One way of thinking about it is if you are a business development person at Twitter that interfaces with external partners, it could be Facebook, it could be like WhatsApp, it could be, there are millions of client applications outside of Twitter's that use the Twitter API. We want to know which is the next client application, what is the next app that is getting so much engagement that either we should reach out to them to see why is it that they're getting so much engagement? Should we broker some special like deal with them? Are they using our ecosystem in a not so good, not like in an abusive way? What's going on? It's like we want some insight into how people are using our API. So like even in this example, you're aggregating on external client applications and you're computing how the number of requests that they're sending to our API or how are they using it. And the third thing is generally internally, Twitter operates many, many different services. We want to measure site traffic. So how many requests come to a particular service? What is our success rate over time? What is our failure rate over time? And so on and so forth. These problems are essentially, all you're doing is you're just simply counting. You're doing a group by and then you're doing a sum. Like all you're doing is counting. This is, what makes this challenging is it's very, very hard to do this at scale. We receive tens of billions of events, many, many, probably more than that, per day. And you want to aggregate on all of these in a robust manner, and you want to do this in real time, because like Twitter intrinsically is a real-time communications platform. So this solving this problem has been a multi-year effort at Twitter. I'm sure most of the people in this room and who are listening are familiar with MapReduce. one of the things that we built at Twitter was a framework which we call Scalding. It was built by engineers at Twitter. It has been open sourced. So if you go to github.com/Twitter, you can find the Scalding repository. Scalding is a very good computational library, and it provides easy wrappers around the MapReduce framework. So you can specify MapReduce jobs in an easy to understand manner. It's kind of, in a way, it's similar in nature to something like the Apache Pig project or to Hive, except it's written in Scala. Scalding allows us to perform time series aggregation. It's a computational library which you can use to perform, to run MapReduce jobs in batch mode. Twitter, about a few years back, we acquired a company called Backtype, which was working on a technology called Storm. Storm is a streaming compute platform. So you can ingest events in real time and aggregate on them or perform whatever computation you want on them. Storm is also open source, and if you Google for it, you can probably find the Storm project as well. The next thing that we did at Twitter was we built a framework called Summingbird. And Summingbird is also been open source, and it's on GitHub. What Summingbird allows you to do is you write the business logic of your Summingbird job once. And Summingbird is this library, translates your job down into a Scalding job and into a Storm job. It can run on different platforms. The two most commonly used ones at Twitter are Storm and Scalding. The business logic has to be written only once, and when you deploy your Summingbird job, what you end up deploying is a Scalding job and a Storm job. So you get not only a batch component to it, but you also get a real-time component to it. Summingbird was a big win for us because now you don't have to write a separate Storm job and a separate Scalding job. You just write one Summingbird job, and the business logic translates into a batch layer as well as a real-time layer. What we realized as our team is that Summingbird was a very, very good computational library. However, one of what it lacks when you're building an analytics dashboard at Twitter is you don't just need a computational library. You also need a service infrastructure to manage many, many of the operational aspects that you need to keep a robust system alive. Some of the examples, and we'll go into many, many much more detail in just a bit, but some of the examples are, if you launch a version of your product that has a few features, as you evolve your product and launch more features on it, you need to evolve the schema. This involves evolving the schema of your job logic itself. It involves evolving the schema of your downstream data stores. Like if you're storing your data inside a key value data store or inside a relational database like Vertica, you need to evolve those data schemas as well. If you have deployed a buggy version of your job for some reason, then you need to correct it and then backfill the old data that you have already computed. You want to aggregate on different time granularities, whether it is monthly or daily or yearly. There are many, many things that are involved in here. You want observability on various components of your service. You want alerting on various components of your service. You want various data integrity checks. So there are many more features that are required when you build a robust analytics product. Summingbird is at the core of Tsar. Tsar builds the Tsar framework is tied very closely to Summingbird, but what it does is it provides a service infrastructure on top of this computational library. So to talk about some of the concrete examples, one of the examples is API aggregates. So if at Twitter we have an API that is used by millions of developers around the world. They hit Twitter's API using a client application ID. And as we said, like a partner relations person or business development person wants to measure how many requests are we getting to every single endpoint over time. This basically, like in English, that's what it means, but what did it actually translate down to? It translates down to you want to bucket by some dimension, which in this dimension might be the API endpoint, which might be the favorites endpoint, or the replies endpoint, or the retweet endpoint. And you want to measure, or you want to compute something. In this case, you're computing the count of number of requests that have been made to this endpoint itself. So you're bucketing by some dimension, you're producing some metric, and then you want to store this data somewhere so you can access it. In this case, for API aggregates, the example that we chose is Vertica. If you're not familiar with Vertica, it's a relational database. It's very similar to MySQL, except it's columnar, as opposed to being a row-based database. We chose Vertica in this example because this is used internally by business development people within Twitter itself. So there is no external facing people who hit it. And so you can use Vertica and you can run complex queries like, give me the top applications who hit this. You can run like limit queries, you can run sorts, you can do et cetera. And there was no need of a higher SLA in this particular example. Another example, which might be, Twitter might launch in the future, might consider launching like a product, which might be, if you go onto your timeline, today you see tweets, you might want to see how many impressions every single tweet received. An impression is essentially a view. Like, if I have viewed a tweet, then that counts as an impression. Like, if I have viewed a tweet that, say, someone in this audience sent out, that counts as an impression. So, again, in this example, what are you doing? You're bucketing by the tweet ID, and you're computing how many impressions this particular tweet ID has received. And then again, so you're bucketing on some dimension, you're computing some metric, and then you want to store it somewhere. So where you store it is inside, like in this case, we chose a key value data store. The reason why we chose a key value data store is because it provides a lower latency and provides a higher SLA guarantee. And we do this because this is a feature that would be turned on in, say, the Twitter's product, and so receives many, many more requests per day than, say, a query to get how many, which is the top client app, how many requests is a particular client application making to Twitter's API. So you have the same model where you're bucketing on some dimension, computing some metric, but you're storing it in a different type of data store. While doing this, you might also want to store a sample of the data in a relational database like Vertica, so you can run some queries on it internally to measure, to get access to some flexible queries that you might want to run. So all of these examples take this basic structure. The first thing you have is you have some event logs. Event logs are, like, any computation that you want to provide is you first need some log data, like you need some source logs to go to. So when a request comes into Twitter's, it hits like our front-end service. Our front-end service services that request. But not only in addition to servicing that request, it also creates a log file. This log file basically makes its way through, we internally typically use Scribe. It makes its way through Scribe, reaches HDFS, and gets stored on HDFS. These event logs typically also get sent to like a Kestrel queue or a Kafka queue, so they can be consumed in real time. So you have some raw event logs that you consume data from. Our SAR job, which I guess think of it as like a Summingbird job, which can be a scalding in batch or storm in real time, consumes these event logs. The first thing it does is it extracts the fields that it cares about. So if you think about the front-end service, it actually logs all the information about the request that it receives and all the information about the response that it sends back. This can include a lot of information, like what is the timestamp, what is the client application that made the request, what was the response code, which data center made the request, what was the version of the client, and there can be like many, many different fields. In your typical aggregation, you may not care about all these 100 fields, you may care about only two or three of them. Like in this case, it might just be the API endpoint and the response code. So you extract the fields that you care about from these raw logs, from every single log. And the next thing you're doing is you're performing some bucketing by whatever dimension you're aggregating on. So this is the group clause. In the previous example, it could have been the group on the API endpoint itself. Then you're measuring something. That is, you could be counting the number of requests that were made to the endpoint. And finally, you store the result in some database somewhere. So any aggregation job takes this form, essentially. So a concrete example might be, these might be some of the raw logs that you might see from the service that services API requests. This has many fields. I've only outlined like three in here. It is the endpoint, the response code, and what was the client application that made the request itself. From this, say the two fields that we only care about are the endpoint and the response code. Like, so you want to measure the count of the response codes for each endpoint. So you extract those two fields itself in this example, and then you're performing some grouping. So you want to group by the API by the endpoint. So essentially, you get a map here from the endpoint to the endpoint and the response codes. So you're doing a group, and then you finally do a measure where you collapse that, and you're basically doing a count over here. So it's a count of the number of elements in the value itself for that particular endpoint. And then you can store this data. So the data you can store, the two examples that we talked about so far, you can store it in a key value database, or you can store it in like something like a Vertica database, depending on your use case. So that's typically what a time series aggregation job looks like. What are some of the problems that you might face with this? Say you're computing this data, you're aggregating this data in real time. What happens if your real-time aggregation service goes down for maybe half an hour because it faces garbage collection issues, or there was like a bad deploy, or someone just killed it by accident, or something happened which causes it to go down? does that mean that, say, the data that we return to, say, BuzzFeed or New York Times, do we basically return 23 and a half hours worth of data to them and say that that's the data for the full day? Typically, you probably don't want to do that. So you need some way of recovering, being fault tolerant to these types of failures. And that's typically a hard problem to solve, especially if you want to aggregate the data in real time. How do you be fault tolerant? Another issue you can come up with is data schema coordination. So you want to store your data. The two examples we talked about are you store your data inside a key value data store or inside, say, something like Vertica. You might also want to store your data back onto HDFS because downstream further jobs might want to pick it up and do some further computation on it. You might want to store your data inside a cache as opposed to just like a storage layer, a persistent storage layer. So when you deploy your job, you need to create data models for each of these layers. Not only that, as you evolve your job, so you might add more features to your job, or add more dimensions to which your job aggregates, or add more metrics to which your job computes, you need to go in and update the data models of each one of these data stores itself. And that can be an operational nightmare or a pain to do every single time. And lastly, this is one of the crucial features of Tsar. It's kind of easy to overlook, and one of the things we made a conscious decision to make this a first-class citizen when we developed Tsar, is making it easy to backfill and repair old data. The two main use cases when this comes up is an engineer wakes up or makes a change to the Tsar job, deploys it. For some reason, the job has a bug in it. It's not the correct version of the job, introduced some buggy version. So now you need to now correct this. But then what about the data that you've already computed and stored inside your key value data store? You need to correct this data. Backfilling this data is typically not an easy problem and something that people realize how hard it is to do once they've actually been operating a job for maybe a month or so. The other useful time when backfills become useful are you've launched a particular version of your product and you've been aggregating on, say, two dimensions. Your product manager comes back to you after 2 months and says, hey, actually, I'm interested in a third dimension as well. Can we begin aggregating on that? So you begin aggregating on that dimension. Now, your job aggregates on time going forward. What about the 2 months worth of data that you've already computed? You want to compute that third dimension for that data as well. So updating historical data, backfills make updating historical data extremely easy as well. There are various problems that the Tsar that can come up with doing aggregations in real time. Tsar tries to solve all of these problems and tries to solve them in a general way, so you don't have to keep solving them again and again. We'll talk briefly about some of the four. Like I've talked about four design principles. This is like the first one of them. So the first one of them focuses to some extent on fault tolerance while providing the recency of real time. Tsar, as I said, builds. It's the core of Tsar is built on top of the Summingbird computational library. The Summingbird computational library kind of gives us this, does a lot of the heavy lifting for us for this particular bullet point. The way it does this is, as I mentioned, every single event that comes into Twitter is enqueued into, is typically logged, and you find that log file on HDFS that you can then pick up and compute, aggregate on in batch mode by a scalding job. But also that event that comes in is also enqueued onto like a Kafka queue or a Kestrel queue that you can then read from and aggregate on in real time. What Summingbird allows you to do is it allows you to process every single event twice. So not only do you process that same event in batch mode, but you also process it in real time as well. So when an event comes in, so if I favorite Jack Dorsey's tweet, for example, that event, that favorite event action of mine would get aggregated on twice, once in batch mode and once in real time. This gives us two main advantages. The batch mode is typically much, much more reliable. It's much, much more fault tolerant. It's been much more tried and well tested. You can also aggregate huge amounts of data here. However, you also want to aggregate in real time because Twitter is indeed a real-time communications platform. You want to give real-time data back to your consumers. So by aggregating in batch in real time, we then store the data into a particular data store. And on top of this data store, you then have a query service, which queries this data store and gives the result back to the client itself. What this query service does is it favors the batch layer over the real-time layer. So if for that particular timestamp, you have data from the batch layer already present, we return the result computed by the batch layer to the client itself. if you don't have result from the batch layer, then we query the real-time result and give that back. So you always favor the data that has been computed by the batch job over the real-time job itself. So typically, your batch job runs maybe, say, on a 24-hour cycle. So right now, today is, like right now, we're at about 4:30 p.m. at the moment. So if you query right now for favorites received like today or in the last hour, the batch job may not have, will probably not have caught up because the batch job needs 24 hours worth of data to be ready, and then it's going to run. So right now, you would get the real-time result back. If you come back and do the same query tomorrow, you will get the result that has been computed by the batch layer, which we believe to be more correct. So kind of the overall picture looks something like this. This term, or this kind of an architecture has been coined Lambda architecture. I believe this term was coined by an engineer called Nathan Mars. So if you look at this diagram, you have an event coming into Twitter's data center. This event gets fanned out on the top into the batch layer and on the bottom into the speed layer. The event gets picked up by the batch layer. It performs some computation on it and then stores the data into some data set. The same event gets picked up by the speed layer, which is your real-time job or your storm job. We perform some computation on it, and we store that in some data store as well. We then have a query service. The query service combines the result of the batch layer and the real-time layer and returns the merged results. So it provides a unified view to the client, and the client gets a unified view, and the query service favors the batch result over the real-time result itself. I see a question.
Do you ever cross-validate, which is to say, your terminal real-time results to see whether they agree with your batch results? In other words, do you use one as a check against the other?
Not as part of the SAR framework. Typically, if we do those kind of checks, those are done like either like you manually test it to make sure that the real-time layer is working exactly as a batch layer works. The advantage to some extent is that since we're using Summingbird, your business logic that you are running in the real-time job and your business and your scal- and your batch job, they are exactly the same because the Summingbird library will like you write your Summingbird job once, but it translates into a batch and a storm job. So the chances that you messed up your business logic of your storm job only, but not your batch job, that basically like isn't there in this case.
Well, but you want to check. I mean, it's around, right?
Agreed. So you can deploy just your batch job in a set and write it to a separate data store. And if you query for it, you will only get the batch results from it if like you set it up that way. And you can deploy only your real-time job and write that, and you can query for the results. And then you can do like manual verification for it. The SAR framework doesn't do that verification for you automatically. Yeah. We simply favor the batch results building on top of Summingbird.
Time you essentially have lost a bunch of batch results. Is there a time when you sort of have a gap where you've got a mix of old and new, old and fixed, and how do you account for that?
What do you mean by you've lost?
You have a bad, somebody does a bad job.
Sure.
And you run for a week.
Sure.
And then you say, oh, and you fix it.
Yep.
And now you restart, starts the backfill from that week.
Yep.
And it's into day three.
Yep.
And you do a query.
Yep.
That would need the data. And now there's three sources of data. There's the new improved data, which is four days old.
The new improved data for 3 days old, some bad data from day three to day seven, and the good data from day seven onwards.
Yeah.
At the moment, we would return we would return exactly that result back to you.
So you do merge across multiple, not just two. You merge
the backfills are done in place, if that's what you ask.
So it doesn't know that it's mixing.
It doesn't know that it's mixing. The query service doesn't know that it's mixing. Okay. Yeah. Exactly.
Are there tags so that the end consumer can actually discern that, in other words, can you actually see? I think this is what you're sort of asking. Is there visibility of this?
Well, you could write a tag and say, as part of your row,
version
X of algorithm or blame.
You could. What I'm saying is at the moment, the SAR framework, the way we built it right now, is that it updates in place. It might be useful to, in the future, like add like a tag for the backfill, like versions. At the moment, we don't actually do that.
That's manual. You could just write it as part of your application.
Well, the backfill is done by the framework itself. So the data that it computes, that's abstracted away from the user itself.
But by application, it's writing rows. And it could write a row, which you just a key in that row, which is automatically generated. which sure. is version of application.
Yep.
Okay.
You want to think, plan ahead and put that tag in, because the time to put that tag in is not when you decided to revise the algorithm.
Right.
You want that tag field to be in place, so that you continue to do it in place, but you're keeping track of what was old and what is new, what's been revised.
Or what was the algorithm, what was the version used? But okay.
Yep.
Well, no, that's a really hard problem. So.
Okay. so my answer to that would be, it might be useful to do at the moment if you wanted to tag your output, you'd have to do it manually. It's possibly something that we could investigate adding, because
it's easy enough. It's a CVS tag, and just insert on that.
Sure.
So, does the streaming subsystem handle bucketing over time periods that essentially are moving windows? Like, I'd like to know the last hour, the last 8 hours, last 24 hours.
So you would have
opposed to fixed boundaries that don't change in time itself. And do they compute them incrementally, or what's the latency?
So the way your streaming compute job would do that is. Say I received an event today, which is at 4:30 p.m., for example, and you're aggregating, say, hourly. We would floor that timestamp down to, say, 4 p.m. and store that data inside, our key-value data store. Say you receive another favorite event on the same endpoint, like you receive another response on the same endpoint at, say, 4:31 p.m., that would also get rounded down to that hour. And then when you store it in the data set, one of the restrictions that we have, and I'd come to it, is any metric that you're computing has to have a monoid structure, so you can add two things together to get back the same thing. So in this case, like in the case of counts, all you want to do is you want to sum the things up. So when the streaming compute job writes the data out again, it would basically, it does a read modify write. So it reads the old value for that key. Since it's a new value, and say you're computing counts, the old value is going to be like some count. So we just add one to it, and we write that result out again as well. Does that answer your question? And so if you were aggregating hourly, and then if you were aggregating, say, daily as well, we would write out two keys, one key which has a timestamp bucketed to 4 p.m., and one which have a timestamp bucketed to, the midnight, exactly.
Yeah, my question was, though, instead of doing it by the date,
mm-hmm.
if I want to look at the data in the last 24 hours, which is...
Oh, I see.
So
if you want to do the last 24 hours, the way you would end up doing that for this job is the way the Tsar framework does is you would say aggregate hourly data, right? And then your query service would have to make a query over 24 hours, and our query service would then sum them up on the server side itself and send the last 24 hours worth of merge result back to the client. That's the way you would do it. Yep.
Is there an aggregation hierarchy where the sums for instance, days are created from the sums from hours, which are created from the sums from minutes?
You can. So, for example, if you store data only hourly and you query for a day's worth of time range, the only data that we have is hourly data. So we would sum all the hours up and give you a result, which will be for the day itself. But if you have daily data that has been computed already, we will favor the daily data. So the query service is smart enough that when it makes a query to the backend store, it queries for the coarsest granularity that's available that matches your query granularity. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, up to the sliding window thing he was asking about, which involves merging sums of days and sums of hours.
Yes,
together.
Exactly. Yes. If you are aggregating on daily granularity and you're also aggregating on hourly granularity,
yeah.
right? And say your query time range is from 3 p.m. August 1st to, say, 7 p.m. October 1st, right? That means you only need to query hourly for the August 1st, from the 3 p.m. to the midnight of hours of August 1st, and you need to query hourly granularity from the midnight to the 7 p.m. of October 1st, and you can query daily in between. So the query service can handle that for you as well.
Can it handle shifting the boundaries of the days by patching them with the information from the hours?
Sorry, maybe I didn't follow you.
Well, it's the granularity of the query. If you're querying daily,
mm-hmm.
but you're doing so on an origin,
an incremental calculation.
So
if you're querying daily, you're
adding in 1 hour and subtracting 1 hour. Rather than recomputing the whole day.
Yeah.
Right. Incremental computation versus going back
if
to the
hour. If your query is daily, one of the things that we enforce is that your query timestamp has to be on the hour, on the day boundary, on the UTC day boundary.
At midnight.
Exactly. Yep.
So
okay. Oh, it can't do it.
Exactly. Yep. Okay. The second design principle is that we separate event production from event aggregation. What I mean by this is that in every single SAR job, it is unique from, like SAR job one can be unique from SAR job two in the sense that you read from, you might read from a different data source. The business logic of whatever bucketing you want to do or the dimensions you want to bucket on might differ from one job to the other. The metrics you want to compute might differ from one job to the other. So those are called like event production where you are extracting from raw logs. The logs you're reading might differ, the extraction you're doing might differ, the bucketing, that the dimension you're bucketing on might differ, and the metrics you're computing might differ. The second part, however, is once you've extracted the relevant fields, the points about event aggregation itself, so how you actually compute the metric. So if you are computing like a count metric, then you want to do some group by, and then you want to do like a sum. If you are computing like a unique metric, then you need to somehow figure out how to compute a unique value on a set of events. If you're doing a ranking, you need to figure out how to compute a ranking on a set of events. So how to do the event production, the other example for event aggregation would be if you are aggregating on hourly versus daily, you then need to floor your timestamps to hourly boundaries and to daily boundaries. These things are all primitives that are very common to every single SAR job itself. So one of the things that we do is we make every user has to write the business logic of their job, which is how they're going to produce the events that they want to aggregate on. But the second step, which is of event aggregation, that is actually performing the bucketing, actually computing the metric, aggregating on the different time granularities, what data store you're going to store the event into, those are all abstracted away from the user. The user doesn't have to write that. Realize I might be talking a little bit in abstract, but when we come to an example of a SAR job itself, this will become a lot clearer itself. The third example is that we have, the third design principle is we provide a unified data schema to the user itself. So the user might want to write their aggregates that it has computed, that he or she has computed, into a relational database like Vertica or MySQL. Might want to write the aggregates that the user has computed into a key value data store. At Tsar, we use something called Manhattan, which is our key value data store. You might want to write your data store into like a cache layer. We support a few syncs that are common, that are useful for various Twitter engineers that are used by us internally. Today, say, we don't have a sync for Cassandra, but like say someone wants their aggregates to be written out into Cassandra, for example. You can write a simple module for the Cassandra sync, plug it into the SAR framework, and then every SAR job from there onwards can now begin writing data out into Cassandra itself. So it's easily extensible to other syncs. And so this is kind of like what like a picture would look like is you have events coming in from either like a Kafka spout or from say HDFS, which is like your event logs. We perform some computation on it. Like we first like write out some intermediate aggregates, which we have computed. And then we have processes that write this data out into either Vertica or into Manhattan in the appropriate format that would be used by these particular data stores itself. And then as you evolve your job or like as you make modifications to your job, we automatically go in and update the data models that you are writing your data out to the various data stores with as well. And the fourth principle is that we provide an integrated service toolkit. So before we actually built SAR, like our team spent a few months, maybe about half a year, when we didn't have the SAR framework and we were building entire analytics pipelines directly on top of Summingbird. A few things that we realized were that there are many things that go into besides just writing a Summingbird job. You need to build this query service that can query the data from the data store that you've written data into, that can merge the results of the batch layer and the real-time layer. You need to have observability on every single batch job, like on all your scalding jobs, on your storm job, on your query service. You want to have observability into what your QPS is to your data store, how much data you're writing into your data store. You also want to have alerting on your data store. So for example, if your job depends on data, like on say the tweet data or some data being on HDFS, if that starts falling behind because the logging pipeline is broken for some reason, you want to be alerted on that. If your storm job starts GCing for whatever reason, you want to be alerted on that. So you want automatic observability and alerting. And these are things which users typically set up after they have deployed their analytics pipeline in production for maybe a few months. you want to have some data integrity checks. So say you're measuring the number of requests that have come into, say, Twitter for iPhone. An iPhone developer who maybe lives in the iOS team on another part of the organization maybe pushes out a new version of the iPhone application, which for some reason like has a logging bug where it starts logging 3x the number of requests, or maybe like stops logging requests or starts dropping requests. You would find that your data becomes incorrect. So the data that you return to BuzzFeed saying the request that BuzzFeed is getting from Twitter for iPhone, that is going to start being incorrect. So you want to have some sort of data integrity checks to check for these things. They're all various components that go into building an analytics pipeline that is robust. And we automatically generate a lot of these things for you. We provide an integrated toolkit that does much of this work, heavy lifting for you automatically. So I've been speaking a lot about SAR and the design principles. Let's dive into an actual, see a question.
Just one question. You've written a number, dozens of analytics pipelines at this point. Check. How many times do you have to write a particular bit of functionality before it makes it into SAR?
At this point, since our team is built SAR, every time we find a feature that we think would be useful.
So you're doing it before one?
At this moment, whenever a use case comes up, there are some things that we build in that we think might be useful directly into the SAR framework, as we're still working on it, adding more improvements to it. Some of the things are if someone comes up with a feature request that is specific to their particular need, that person is probably already using the SAR framework and then realizes that, hey, SAR doesn't have this feature. So we build that into the SAR pipeline, SAR framework automatically. The usefulness of that is that today, whenever the next person wants to write a SAR job, they automatically get that feature for free. They don't have to wait for us to implement it.
Cool. Who defines the sorts of events that there are?
Could you clarify what you mean by sorts of events?
Well, you speak of events, but I don't know what an event is.
So an event could be a favorite event. So if you go back to my initial example where, see if I can get there.
It's the arrival of a packet at a server which says I'm an event. In other words...
It sounds like a message. I want to know what it is in SAR. I know what a message is.
Well, there's anonymous.
So an example event would be what I have on my screen right now. So what is this event saying? This event is saying that I got a request that was made, if you look at the second line, it's an event that says that some user used the Twitter for iPhone application to make a request to the favorites endpoint, and that service that user's request serviced it successfully and logged a 200 response code.
Okay, so all the events are exogenous. There are no events produced by your system.
No, there are no events that are produced in this case by our system. Okay. We are aggregating on log data, essentially.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep, thank you. Here we go. So this is a concrete example. I'm going to try and focus on this. The next slide has an example of a SAR job itself. So in this example, I'm going back to the tweet impressions example that I've been talking about, which is, you have tweet IDs that come into Twitter. You want to count the number of impression events, number of impressions that every single tweet has received. So in this example, you're bucketing by the tweet ID, and you're computing impressions on those tweet ID. Think about this problem. You have about 500 million tweets that come into Twitter every single day. These tweets actually get fanned out to many, many followers. It gets fanned out to many people. And the number of impression events that receive is many orders of magnitude higher than the number of tweets. The number of tweet events that comes into Twitter is actually a pretty small data source for us. It's those actions on those tweet events that the followers produce that actually dwarfs the number of tweet events that comes in. So you have millions of tweet events that come in, but the number of impression events goes into the billions. And you want to aggregate on this in real time.
So you didn't specify the time frame? In this example,
the metric I'm computing is counts. I believe I'm going to be computing daily aggregates. I'm going to be computing daily. Yep, exactly.
So I take it that all these histograms are running in parallel in order to process the data stream once. In other words, you've rebalanced the shape of the job so that you're running a whole bunch of these histograms in parallel.
I'm not sure I follow what you mean by running histograms in parallel.
Well, I mean, But if you're like plowing through lots of data, you don't want to plow through the data looking for one particular profile when you can plow through it once and...
You're computing number of impressions received on every single tweet. Your job is, like the SAR job itself, aggregates on impression every single tweet that's coming into Twitter. And then in your query service, what you're doing is, whenever the user loads his or her timeline, whatever the tweet IDs are that are going to be put into his timeline, that service that displays that on the front end makes a call to our query service and says, hey, these are the 10 tweet IDs that I'm going to be putting onto user X's timeline. Can you give me the impression events on each one of these tweet IDs? So it makes a multi-get call, essentially, that says, here are 10 tweet IDs. Can you do your lookup into the data store to give me the data that I have already computed and return the impression counts for each one of these 10 tweet IDs?
So this happens for every increment of a histogram bucket, is what I'm hearing.
Yes.
So the whole idea of co-residing histogram arrays and moving the increment operator to be close to the histogram so that the read, modify, write overheads are minimized is not happening yet?
I'm not sure what you mean.
I mean, I can show you how to do this afterwards.
Sure. Maybe I'm not following your question.
Okay.
I'm happy to talk about it afterwards. Yep. So any SAR project has three components to it. We have a Scala file, which is the SAR job itself, where the business logic of your job resides. We have a configuration file. And at Twitter, we use Thrift. Thrift is used for two things at Twitter, which is like it's used for RPC, so it's like calling different services. So for example, our query service is a Thrift service. And we also use it, it's also used to store data. So like typically the log files that are stored on HDFS are also Thrift encoded. So the first thing is your Thrift file that we define here is in this Thrift file, what you define are only the attributes that you care about. So these are the fields that you extract from the raw logs itself. So in the tweet impressions example, probably the field that you would probably extract would probably include tweet ID. I should update my slides. I will do that after this talk. but like, I should have basically had tweet ID in here. The other fields you might be interested in: what is the client application that made that the particular user made to make that impression event itself? So these are the fields that you extract from the raw logs itself.
This is a question of scale.
Sure.
Are there any 32-bit numbers left at Twitter?
No, we converted to all 64-bit.
So either 64-bit or Google.
Yes. Yeah. So like all our Thrift stocks use I64s. Here we go. So that's the first example of an actual SAR job itself. And we'll walk through the SAR job like step by step through every single line so you can see what we're talking about. So the first thing that I want to draw your attention to is the onKeys block. So the very top of the SAR job, the things that are highlighted in blue, is the SAR DSL. So that's a custom DSL that the SAR has that we've written that we think allows you to specify a time series aggregation job in an easy manner. So the first block, which is the onKeys block, in this block, you define the various dimensions that you want your job to aggregate on. In this case, you're computing impression counts on tweets. The dimension you're aggregating on is the tweet ID itself. The next thing is the produce block. So the produce block are the metrics that you are computing. In this case, the metric you're computing is a count metric. So counts of number of impressions that every single tweet has received. If you want to compute more metrics, you can, like, it's a comma separate list, and you can add metrics in here. We support several inbuilt metrics. They include like counts, uniques, rankings, standard deviations, means, max, min, et cetera. If we have a metric that we don't support right now, you can add the module for that metric and plug it into the SAR framework yourself. The sync to block is the data store you want to write data to. In this case, this is Manhattan. Manhattan, as I said, is our key value data store. This could also very well be like Vertica, MySQL, whatever it be. And then you have the from producer block. So the from producer block is the actual summing but fragment. So this is the business logic of the user. That the user is writing. So let's walk through what this is doing. This is saying, let's read from the client event source. So the client event source is the log files that are produced by the Twitter owned and operated clients. So the Twitter-owned and operated clients include like Twitter for iPhone, Twitter for BlackBerry, Twitter for Android, Twitter for iPad, et cetera, so on and so forth. Whenever a user uses any of these Twitter-owned and operated clients, our clients send information back to Twitter's data center that say that a user impressed a particular tweet or a user favorited a particular tweet. And these get logged as what we call like client events. The client event source is essentially just a wrapper which says, I'm going to read from Kafka spout, from the Kafka spout that gives me these client events, and I'm going to read from the HDFS log file that contains these client events as well. So that's the client event source. The first thing I want to do is I want to filter down to only impression events. So the client event source could contain, it could contain favorites, it could contain replies, it could contain retweets. In this example, I'm only interested in impression events. So I filter down to whether the event is an impression event or not. And the next thing in the map field, sorry, in the map block, all I'm doing is I'm extracting the fields that I care about. So in this case, I have the event, and all I actually need here is the tweet ID that I'm aggregating on. So I already know that at this point, all that event that I have is an impression event because I already filtered down to impression events. The only field that I need at this point is the tweet ID field. And what I output is simply a tuple, which is the timestamp the event occurred at and the impression event itself, which contains the fields that I care about. If you notice in here, there is no aggregation logic that is being specified in this job itself. I'm not specifying any group by in here that I want to group by the dimensions that I want to bucket by. I haven't specified any sums in here, so how am I actually going to compute my count? I haven't specified the data model, like what is my key value data structure when I'm going to write my logic out to my Manhattan, my key value data store. All of that is abstracted away from the user. The user only has to specify the business logic of how the user is going to produce the events, extract the relevant fields and produce the events from the raw source logs and the dimensions and metrics the user wants to compute itself. This is like an example configuration file. So in this configuration file, we have a namespace, which can be like, in this example, it can be like impressions, the name of your job, the user who is deploying the job itself, the name of the thrift struct that you were deploying the things with. And then the outputs block is what I want to draw your attention to. In there, what I'm saying is, what are the sinks that I'm going to write my data to, and what are the time granularities that I'm going to aggregate on? So in this case, I'm aggregating on daily granularity. So if you go back to this SAR job in here, in this SAR job, I'm not like rounding my timestamps down to like daily granularity or anything. The configuration file, which says that I have that I'm going to aggregate on one day, is enough information for SAR to know what to do. So all of this logic is abstracted away from the user entirely, making it easier for the user to get up and running with a SAR job.
I can have a list of outputs.
So you can have a list of outputs.
Daily, monthly.
Exactly. Exactly. So the things that we specified in here are what is the event schema, that is your thrift file itself. We specified how we're going to produce the events, but not how we're going to aggregate on it. We specified the dimensions we want to aggregate on. We specified what are the time granularities that we want to aggregate on, and what are the sinks that we want to write our data to.
That one said sync intermediate thrift. The previous job said sync Manhattan, so it's not used for either of those two lines.
Intermediate thrift is our, sorry, if, let me try going back to explain intermediate thrift.
Forget whether it's intermediate thrift. Let's ignore intermediate thrift. The one that said Vertica, since that sync was Vertica, and this thing said sync to Manhattan, mm-hmm. It's not going to be run on the Vertica schedule.
No, it'll only run. So whatever you will sync your job to is, sorry, screens are flipping around. Sorry, trying to get to. Yeah. So in here, So that's a typo.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a typo. Sorry, so that should be sync.manhattan.
But if it said sync Vertica, then the Manhattan job wouldn't run.
No, it would not. Okay. No, exactly. Okay. Yep. That's a typo.
It's example.
Yeah.
It's a bug.
It yeah.
See if we're paying attention.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So these are the things that you specify, your event schema, how you're going to produce the events, the dimension you're going to aggregate on, the time granularities, and the sinks. What you don't specify is how you're going to represent the aggregated data. So what is my key value data model inside my data store? If I want to store my data inside Vertica or MySQL, What are the various columns that I need to create in my SAR job itself? Those have not been specified. What are the projections I want to create, et cetera? Like, none of that has been specified. How I'm going to perform my aggregation, how I'm going to connect to these services. That's all abstracted away from the end user over there.
So do I understand it right that you're doing read, modify, write increments into the database?
Yes. Not inside Vertica, but inside in the key value data store, yes. Inside Vertica, we have a separate loader process that loads the data into the into the database.
Has anyone looked at the overheads associated with that?
Could you clarify what you mean by overhead?
Well, I mean, what kind of overhead are you talking about? And we know that in a minimized system, you've got a histogram array, and you do a read, modify, write memory cycle, perhaps that histogram array is in the cache, okay?
Sure.
And at the opposite extreme, the database is on another machine. And since it needs to be an atomic operation, you can't do a read and a write without, I mean, is the increment in part of the database system?
Yes, the increment is part of the database system. Like, our key
value
data
store. Okay, so it's atomic.
The key value data store supports like counters, for example.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so you're not doing a read and a write.
No.
It's that
operation is atomic, and we also, whenever we do writes, we do it with like local, we do it with quorums.
And this is the only job writing that table anyway.
Yes, exactly. So what I just mentioned is when we're writing into data like MySQL or Vertica, that data is being, we compute the aggregate and then that gets loaded in as a batch load into the relational database. For the strong job, for the bad job, is for your scalding job that's running, which might load data into key value data store, we again have a loader process that loads the data into the key value data store. For the strong job that's computing data in real time, that is doing a read, modify, write.
But it's only one of these SAR jobs for each table.
Yes, exactly. They're sandboxed. The data sets are sandboxed.
There are two jobs modifying the same table.
No.
So there's no
rate.
Yep.
No atomic need for atomic.
Well, there isn't. It is atomic as far as it's atomic. It just doesn't require
a single process.
Yeah, it's atomic for free.
Okay.
Different question.
Sure.
When you have a lot of those analysis processes running, I assume that there's a lot of duplicate computation going on. Basically, the multiple analysis pipelines are computing the same intermediate results if they filter on the same tweet ID or whatever and aggregate the impressions.
Well, that's part of your question is like, there might be two teams within Twitter who might be computing impressions on tweets.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your question, right?
Yeah. So there will be, in the end, two batch jobs running doing the same thing.
Well, so that would be like, so my answer to that is like, that is, seems more like a cultural thing in the sense that Twitter needs to make sure that, Twitter is like engineering as an organization, we need to make sure that you don't have duplicative effort being done in two parts of the organization.
But why don't automatically spot the fact that
someone's
doing the same query?
How do you spot the fact that someone's doing the same query? You're going to two separate query services.
Well, you hash the query and you check in the table of all results already computed.
You're two different SAR jobs are writing into two different data sets. They're not writing to the same data set, and they have their separate queries.
The program equivalence problem, which is still pretty hard.
Well, you're assuming that they don't have identical queries.
Well, even if they have, like, typically your two people won't write exactly the same SAR job. Like, we have some, like, you're not going to write exactly the same SAR job. You might be computing kind of similar data, and there might be an argument that you can consolidate that into one job.
Right.
That's typically what is much, much more common.
Three jobs, sort of a background job, making some common data, and then two
individual. That's typically more common, and like, so you can spot those things. To answer your question, like, two separate SAR jobs are completely sandboxed from each other. Like, they have separate scalding jobs, separate storm jobs, they're writing into separate data stores, they have separate query services. There's no way for the SAR framework itself to detect that there are two exactly same queries that are being made, because those queries are made from two different JVM processes, and they hit two completely different storage systems, storage data sets within the data system itself. That answer your question?
Well, obviously they don't notice that they could have.
Yeah, so that's part of more of an organizational thing. Is like Twitter is an organization. We need to figure out that like our we do our best. Like you have maybe two or three analytics teams at Twitter. It's like, okay, if I already have this data, let's not write another job that does exactly the same thing, because that's expensive. You're computing this, you're using the same resources again. So let's get better documentation in there. Let's create a better...
You can do this on paper as opposed to in a hash table that spots duplicate queries. Whether the computer does it or whether the human being does it. That's what I'm getting at.
Your query may not, like, your query is not, like, you're never going to have exactly the same query. Like, you're not going to have two people who write exactly the same SAR job. Like, the chances of that are very, very, very low. So I actually believe the chances of that are, like, very, very, very low.
I think what you said is certainly true, but it does seem to me more likely that intermediate results, elements of the query, may be replicated across multiple users. That ultimately the final output they're getting are distinct, but they're each computing things hourly that they could have computed once instead of twice, and using it in some other
or hundreds of times is like a pack rat compiler. Caches results for it, does speculative look ahead, and then it'll abort, but it will cache those results so that when it asks exactly the same question again a little further down the road, it doesn't have to do an exponential explosion. It already has the answer. So they get rid of exponential explosion by caching prior queries and noting that things are pure functions. So I think that I'm asking that question.
The answer is no.
He's pointing out that the intermediate results, there could be big payback.
The intermediate results are stored in HDFS. They aren't even stored in a data set. What you store inside your key value data set is a completely aggregated result.
Okay.
And we can take this offline want. When it, we have like,
so those intermediate HDFS are also isolated from each other.
Yes. The two SAR pipelines and their outputs all the way through are completely isolated from each other. Okay. Lastly, so this SAR job, one of the things that SAR provides is we focus on operational simplicity. And so SAR has, the SAR code base is written in two main things. Like, we have the Scala, we have a Scala component, and we also have a Python component, which composes and builds what we call the SAR tool. So when you run a command using the SAR tool, which is SAR deploy, and you deploy to the production environment, this deploys a host of things. It launches your Hadoop jobs, your scalding jobs. It launches your Storm jobs for you. It launches your query service for you. It can launch various loader processes that load your data, the bad job results into your MySQL or Vertica database or into your Manhattan database. We typically use Mesos as our scheduler. We automatically launch or create your Mesos configs for you, so you don't have to handcraft every single Mesos config. So we can deploy your jobs onto Mesos automatically. We generate observability for every single component of your pipeline, like your bad job, your storm jobs, your query service. We also create alerts for every single pipeline. We automatically go in and auto-create your tables for you inside MySQL or Vertica, so you don't need to go in and create tables and projections yourself. And we can also create automatic data regression and anomaly checks for you. So there are many stages, many things that you need to do for an analytics pipeline. It's cumbersome for the user to have to do it again and again. So in the SAR tool, one command can deploy all of these things for you automatically. So a bird's eye view of the SAR pipeline looks something like this. So at the very bottom, you have some event logs, like your HDFS log data or your Kafka streams. These come in. The HDFS log data is processed by a scalding job in batch mode. Your Kafka streams are processed by a storm job in real time. Your HDFS log data can write data out into, it writes data into HDFS, finally gets loaded into either a Vertica or a MySQL database, or you can write it into Manhattan, which is a key value data store. Your storm job or your real time job only can't write data into a Vertica database. We write data into Manhattan. So if you're writing data into Manhattan, we then combine this data, and we typically use a library called Storehouse, which Summingbird builds on top of as well, which combines the batch and real-time layers in some query service. And then this query service or the Vertica database can be queried for the aggregated results, and you get a time series out of it that you can then display somewhere. I'm going to move on. I actually have some parts of my presentation. I put questions in here because I thought you'd stop this point for questions, but since we've been stopping anyway. Like, it's completely okay. Like, it's fine. So the part in here, so some of the features that you might want to see in a typical SAR job is, so far you've been computing number of impressions on tweet IDs. Today, say 3 months down the line, you might find a need for, or your PM comes back and says, hey, I actually want to know which client application is most common. So I want to compute tweet. I want to compute the dimension broken down by tweet ID and client application. In SAR, adding a new dimension is as simple as adding a single line in here. You add tweet ID, comma client application ID, and then in the fields that you're extracting at the bottom, you extract the client field as well. And you redeploy your job, and we will automatically go in. So previously, your Vertica database might only have had two columns, which was the tweet ID and the impressions received on that tweet ID, and say all the various days. Now we will automatically go in and issue like an alter table command for you to create the additional column. You don't have to go in yourself and do it. You don't have to define how this, what the key value data structure is going to be for this new dimension if you're storing data inside a key value data store. You don't have to update your storm job and your scalding job. You don't have to go in and do any of this stuff. You automatically deploy this and you get the new, you begin aggregating on the new dimension automatically.
You have to shut down the old ones?
No, we update it. It's an update. Yep. So what about the historical data? So you've computed data, like you made this change 3 months later. What about the data that's already been computed? You want to backfill it or update it, or you want to aggregate on this new dimension for that period as well. You run a SAR backfill command, and you specify a start time and an end time, and we run the backfill for that period for you. This backfill runs in parallel to the production job. So we don't hamper the production. The production job continues to aggregate data going forward. In parallel, there's a backfill job that runs and keeps updating this historical data or keeps backfilling this data itself. So it's useful for preparing historical data and for also, yeah.
Why doesn't it know start and stop, start and end?
Why doesn't it know start and end?
Because it knew when I started the old thing.
Sure. Well, what happened in the case where I've deployed a job from, say, day 1 to day 7, on day 8, I make an update and I deploy my job, and it's broken until day 14, and then I deploy a new version again at day 14. So I only actually want to backfill the days 8 to 14. I don't want to backfill from day 1.
Does it keep track of all your starts and all your deploys so that you can sort of guess, or so you can get the right range?
Whenever SAR deploys, like what we do is like, For whatever version of the job you've deployed, like you can go into like your Mesos, like the Mesos file, and you can look at the SHA, like the SHA, the Git SHA, the branch you deployed from. We typically send a deploy email out as well. So it's when an engineer realizes, hey, this deploy was incorrect. So you check when that deploy was made, and then you backfill from that date.
Okay, it's just that trusting me to type start and stop numbers correctly is just
exactly
not going to happen.
Yes, exactly. See,
can't
so
go
far,
back later and change it.
Huh?
If you made a mistake, you can't go back later and change it.
You
backfill again.
You can backfill again.
Yeah. Backfill from the beginning of time.
Yeah.
Until present.
Yeah. So far, say you've been computing only daily aggregates, and you now want to add all time. In your configuration file, you add a single line. You redeploy your job. You don't have to modify your Scala job file to floor your timestamp to like 0 for all time. Or like monthly granularities, like you don't have to output these separate keys. SAR takes care of this automatically for you. So you make this config change, you deploy a job, you get this. Sorry.
It's all time, or you mean any
time? All time would just mean like if you query for the tweet ID, you get the number of impression counts received from the time. All time in this case, I guess actually means from the origin of your job to the present time.
So does it mean till from 1970?
No, it does not, yeah. Because the SAR job, SAR was not invented then. The job has not been running since then, no. Automatic metric computation. So far, we've been computing total counts. So if I view a particular tweet, and then I view it again 3 hours later, that counts as two views. Probably a better metric might be, what is the unique audience? How many unique people have seen my tweet? So you want to compute a unique count. So you do unique user ID, and you get that metric. And you redeploy your job, and you extract the user ID field, and you deploy your job, you begin computing uniques. Good question, I guess. Like, so if I've been computing uniques, I've been aggregating my job daily. So I have some unique users who have impressed this tweet today. who impressed this tweet day before yesterday for day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, if my query comes in and says, hey, give me the number of unique impressions, unique users who have impressed this tweet in the last 1 week, how do I resolve this particular query? Can I just add the 7 unique values back and return that result?
No.
Okay. Good answer. How do I solve this particular example then? How do I solve this?
Recompute over a week basis.
Recompute at query time?
Yeah. Not at query time, but you could just do another SAR job that does it on a weekly basis.
Exactly. So that would have to be like an asynchronous query, like query and then you run a SAR job and your job maybe takes like 3 days to compute 7 days worth of data. So what SAR actually does on the back end here is for uniques, there's a data structure called hyperloglog, which allows you to compute approximate uniques. So you can combine, what we store inside the Manhattan database is a hyperloglog that represents the number of unique impressions that that tweet received on day one. Then we store a hyperloglog that represents the number of impressions that tweet received on day two, and so on for the remaining days. And when you query for a 7-day window, what we do is we combine 7 different hyperloglogs to create a fatter hyperloglog, which we then resolve at query time and return the computed unique value back to the client itself. Hyperloglogs are very efficient in terms of computational efficiency and also in terms of storage efficiency. And you can tune different parameters, like what your error threshold should be. Like, what is the error threshold that you are comfortable with? Like, do you want to set it to 1%? Do you want to set it to 0.5%? Are you OK with like a 5% error? Depends on applications. And you can tune that. The other thing which we do in the back end, which I guess is built into the hyperloglog data structure itself today, because like, I guess my manager committed this code to the hyperloglog data structure, is you can use an eventually hyperloglog. And what that means is, say if like you are OK with like a 1% error, but you a particular tweet receives only, say, 3 impressions, or say 2 impressions. Since it's a 1% error, like that 2 might actually come down to like 1, or may actually go down to 0 for just like, it's not actually 1%, but like if that happens, then it's a lot worse to say that a tweet that was supposed to receive 2 impressions actually got 0. Like, that's really bad. It's probably OK to say that a tweet that received 1 million impressions actually received 1,000,001 impressions. And so what we do is we store an exact set up to some cutoff threshold, which may be set to like 1,000 entries. And only when that threshold of that, the cardinality of that set increases or goes beyond that threshold, then do we convert it and store it as a hyperloglog. So these things are automatically built into the SAR framework. Like, you are a user of SAR, and you come in and you want to compute uniques, you don't actually want to go ahead and implement how to aggregate hyperloglogs, how to store a hyperloglog, how to represent that in my data store. SAR does that for you automatically on the back end. Some of the other data structures, like if you think about a ranking, that requires you to store a map, like a map of an entry to the count, like map of key values, where the value is the count of the number of times that key was seen. Then you have to combine different maps, and this can be expensive. So similarly, for rankings, we use another approximate data structure called the sketch map data structure. And you can combine various sketch maps to get back a fatter sketch map, which you can then resolve finally at query time to return the map itself back to the user. And then we support for multiple syncs. So if you have been persisting data to...
Sure. Sketch map, you can also suggest the accuracy that you want.
Exactly. Yep. And same thing, like you can set a threshold for which you want to store an actual map, and then once it exceeds that threshold, the cardinality of the map exceeds that, you then convert it to a sketch map. All of these data structures are actually inside a very cool library called AlgebraBird, which Summingbird integrates with and is also available on GitHub today. We also support multiple syncs. So if you want to store data inside, you've been storing data inside Manhattan, you now care about storing data inside MySQL, you add that one line to your configuration file, you redeploy your job, and you start getting data inside MySQL as well. So a typical SAR workflow looks something like you create your job, you deploy it, you make some modifications to it, you deploy it again. If you want to, if you care about making those modifications in the past, you then run a backfill job as well. So there are three like basic problems that your SAR job solves. There's a problem of computational management, which is you have some source logs which you want to extract data from. You want to compute some data on it. You want to aggregate on something, compute some metrics, and you want to store that somewhere. Then it leads to the problem of some data set management, which is you have various data sinks that you have. Like it could be Manhattan, it could be Vertica, it could be a cache, it could be whatever. You want to define data models for each of these, and you have to update each of these when you deploy your job itself. Tsar handles the data set management aspect for you. And the third aspect, which is the service management, which is you have query services which you have to deploy. You want observability on each part of your each part of your analytics pipeline. You want alerting on each part of your analytics pipeline. You want data integrity checks. Tsar integrates. Tsar performs all of these three functions for the user itself. So if there's like one key takeaway that like the Tsar framework tries to do is we try like the end-to-end management of the data pipeline is Tsar's key feature. Like the user only needs to implement the core business logic of the pipeline itself. Cool. That's all I got. Thank you.
Integrity checks are built into the systems, so it's a little hard to know ahead of time. But would you, for example, notice if there was an app which always incremented the count by three?
Mm-hmm. So
that's something you'd look
right. So the kind of integrity checks that we build is we have a system at Twitter which is called like OddDuck, from another name. It basically provides anomaly detection. So what it does is, for example, if you're writing daily aggregates out to say Vertica, what OddDuck would do is every day, it makes a query inside Vertica and say gets like, and it basically sees how many impression events has iPhone produced today versus yesterday versus the day before, and like it makes these queries every single day and it builds up a statistical model. It uses R, it builds up statistical models, and it checks is my impression count for today X standard deviations above what I expect it to be, above or below what I expect it to be, and if so, then fire an alert. So that's the kind of observability that we have. So OddDuck today supports only these offline queries where it can only query, like it does these queries to Vertica or database, like anything which can support a JDBC driver. We're in the process right now of integrating OddDuck with the Tsar query service itself, so you can alert on things in real time itself by querying the key value data store. Does that give you
Is
the value above
instabilities? Threshold defined.
Exactly. So it's some value today is some threshold above or below what it should be.
But should be means
should be is something what you define.
Day before, something like that.
A day? No. Like we build a model like over a week, perhaps.
A week, something.
Or like something you can configure that again.
But it's canned.
Exactly. Yep. Exactly. Yeah.
How does Tsar compare with other open source solutions like a similar job like OpenTSDE?
I don't think I'm that qualified to speak about that because I'm not too familiar with those. I'm not sure, like at least when we started off working on the Tsar framework, we didn't find, the main purpose when we built Tsar was we wanted to compute these time series aggregations, and like it was built at Twitter, right? It was built for Twitter engineers itself, like that was for our use case. So we wanted to integrate with various data systems that we had like Manhattan, MySQL, et cetera. I'm not too familiar with whether the systems that you're talking about, whether they have various features like schema evolutions, metric computations. I'm not aware of it. When we did our initial research, we didn't find any system like that, which is kind of why we ended up building Tsar, I think. It's possible that our research may not have been complete.
When was this started?
This project started off like during Hack Week of last year. So it started off, like the first line of code were written for this April of last year. It was basically worked on by three people for most of last year, which is like me and two other people at Twitter. And then today, like we have a team of like 10 people who work on the framework itself. Yeah.
Were there any of those three people DevOps people? Because it seems like it's sort of a lot of DevOps stuff, which is not...
All three of us are software engineers. We're a software engineer when we built it.
Okay.
The reason why we built it is a lot of it is like, as you said, like there is a lot of operational burden which you actually have to go to if you're running an analytics pipeline, and like these were burdens that like we had to take on as software engineers. Like every time you wanted to update your job, there were so many things you had to do. Like you had to go in, update your Scala job file. Like say if you were aggregating daily granularity and you now want to aggregate monthly, you have to go into your Tsar job, change it so that it not only outputs an event for daily, with the timestamp rounded to daily, but also a timestamp rounded to monthly. You also then need to go into your Vertica database and create a new table column for that. You need to update your loader process with the new thrift schema so it actually picks up the new dimension that you updated. So you have to deploy each one of these things, and they all have to be coordinated. so that like you don't like have some incorrect thing. And it was very error prone, very cumbersome, and that was, and like we worked for maybe 4 months without Tsar, and we were like, okay, this is too much. Let's build a proper framework that manages these things for us. Yeah.
So, have you actually seen your product managers? I don't know what they're called. The users of the system increase their utilization of the system.
Yep.
By Tsar.
It makes it a lot.
Any quantification of?
There's no quantification, unfortunately. But the best thing that I can say for that is, it's a lot easier today. It's an abstract thing. It's not a quantified statement because it's a hard to quantify problem, right? It's like analytics products at Twitter. Like, a way of quantifying possibly is like how many analytics products that we launch last year versus how many are we launching this year, for example. Like, that's one way of looking at it. I would say that most of the analytics products I've launched, another way of measuring it is like satisfaction. It's like, how hard was it for someone to launch an analytics product last year versus how hard was it to launch it this year? And that's a much, much harder problem to quantify, right? It's like you have to talk to people.
But it is easier to quantify the number of times somebody had got a call because they didn't change something they were supposed to change. And
how many pages did you do? How many alerts do you get? Basically,
like, or how many?
How many mistakes did you make?
How many mistakes? Sure. Yeah, how many?
I can speak for our team, and I can say it's a lot fewer.
Right.
It's enough. We haven't quantified it, but like, I can speak from our team. It's been a lot fewer. We used to make so many of them before.
We'll talk about the Yahoo bug database when the camera comes off.
Okay. All right.
Cool.
Yeah. All right. Thank you, everyone.